Let me ask you a question. Why did the Lord save you? Now think about that for a minute. I did a survey once and asked various people that question just to see what answer they would give me. One lady said, for fellowship. He wanted to save us so we would have fellowship with him. And then she quoted the Westminster Catechism, which teaches that men were created to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Now, there's some truth to that answer, but let me probe that answer. Did the members of the Trinity have fellowship with one another before they created the earth and us? And was that fellowship sufficient within themselves to satisfy that need for fellowship? In other words, why would the Trinity need us for fellowship? Interesting. Another lady said, God created us because we are lost and we need it. Again, there's some truth to that. Still another chimed in and added, because God loves us. No doubt God loves us, or he wanted to save us because we were lost and desperately needed. But is that the reason he created us, and is that the reason he saves us? One man I talked to gave me the standard answer. We are saved to serve. Some saints even get more specific and say, believers are saved so they can be soul winners, which after all is a form of service. Now, it's clear from the scripture that God wants us to serve him. But is that the ultimate reason he decided to forgive us? Let me probe that one a bit. In the book of Galatians, Paul contemplates the possibility of angels preaching the gospel. Would they not do a better job than we do? They wouldn't make all the foul-ups we do. So is that the reason God saved us, so that we could tell other people about him and win them to Christ? Here's the question. Why did God save you? I'm sure there are multiple answers to that question. But I think there's one answer that towers above all the others. It is the ultimate answer to that question, and it is recorded very simply and plainly in Ephesians chapter 2. So will you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2? Part of this passage is really rather well known. You will recognize some of the verses in it. But I dare say you've not taken much time to look at those verses in the context of the passage. So let's begin by looking at verse 1, where Paul says, and you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also, we were once conducted ourselves in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even just as the others. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This passage is very logically divided into two parts. In the first part of the passage, which goes from verses 1 through verse 3, Paul describes what we were like before we became Christians. And then, in verses 4 to 10, he describes the process by which we got saved, and in the process of doing that, tells us why God did it. So there's a lot here, and let's go back at verse 1 and begin by just seeing how God describes us or thinks of us before we were saved or before we became Christians. Verse 1 says, "But you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins." So the first description of what we were like before we became to Christ is we were dead. Did you know that you were dead after you were born, and you were still walking, but you were dead? You were talking, but you were dead? Now, that makes no sense. What in the world are you talking about? Well, obviously, he's not talking about physical death, because we were born physically and we walk around talking and doing things. That's not the idea. Rather, in the context of this passage, it's obvious that he's saying that we were dead spiritually. Now, what we need to do is define what it means to be dead. I've often described this by saying, if I were to die right now, somebody were to shoot me or I died of a heart attack, my body would slump to the floor, but I would go somewhere else. In other words, physical death is the separation of the body and the soul. We know that every time you go to a funeral, we talk about that person being in a better place, but we're looking at their body. So death is the separation of two things. Now, when I say we are dead spiritually, I mean that we are dead spiritually, that we are separated from God, that we are alienated from Him. We are not connected or related to Him. Now, there are some who take this concept and they push it to the nth degree, as if to say there is nothing in man whatsoever that can respond to spiritual truth. I actually had a pastor once tell me, if you want to understand this, go to the funeral home and look at the corpse in the casket and say to that corpse, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved." And obviously the corpse wouldn't do that, couldn't do that. And he said, that's what it means to be dead. Well, that's interesting, but it's not biblical. And the reason I know that is in Acts chapter 17, Paul talks about those that don't know the Lord groping after God. Doesn't sound like a corpse to me. We're told in Romans chapter 1 that you ought to be able to look at creation and understand some things about the Creator. That the visible things of creation ought to tell you about some of the invisible things of God. Namely, that He has power, for example. And then there's one other indication of what dead means in the Scripture. In the story of the prodigal son, the son took his part of the inheritance and went to a far country. He ends up in a pig pen and decides he'd be better off in his father's house, and he comes back. And when he does, the father says he was dead. Now, obviously, he wasn't dead physically, but he was dead in terms of his relationship to his father. And that's what the concept of dead means in the Bible. We were in sin. We were in that state, and in that state we were separated from God. So, he's describing what unbelievers are like, what we were like before we came to Christ, and he says we were dead. There's more. Look again at the passage and look at verse 2, in which you once walked according to the course of this world. By the way, this is a very fascinating statement. In the first place, the word according to in Greek means the standard. This is the standard by which you walked, and walk is the way you lived. It's a reference to lifestyle. So this is the standard by which you lived your life, the course of this world. The Greek word translated course actually means age. And the word translated world is used in the scripture in many different ways. God created the world. God so loved the world. In the first, he's talking about God created the physical world. In the second, God loves the people in the world. But the word is also used of the fact that Satan is the god of this world. And as the god of this world, he is the god of this system. As a matter of fact, the word world means system. It's cosmos, from which we get the word cosmetics. It's a system of putting things in order, and Satan is the head of that, and the whole point of that system is it leaves God out. So putting all that together, what this comes down to is that before we were Christians, we lived according to the standard of the current age of the world. That's how we ordered our lives. So that the governing principle that we followed is the values and attitudes of the world in which we lived, particularly the current age, the current fads, the current fashions that's referred to in this verse as course, age. It's the current form of the world. In other words, we live according to the world around us. We have peer pressure that we bow to. We conform to the present age. We're molded to our environment. Unbelievers act and live like unbelievers. They march to the drum of the world. They're certainly not alive unto God. And that's the point. They are dead. They are separated from God. And they live like that, according to the course of this world. So, we're describing unbelievers. We were once unbelievers. We're separated from God, and we're living according to the environment we live in. That's the basic idea. Then he says in verse 2, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the sons of disobedience, which is an obvious reference to Satan. And again, he uses the word according to, so we lived according to the standard of Satan. Wow. He calls Satan the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the sons of disobedience. Now, this is not saying that we're all Satan worshipers. That's not the idea. Matter of fact, 1 John chapter 5, verse 19 says, the whole world lies in the wicked one. Now, this is what people are not aware of, but they've been influenced by Satan. Remember, Satan is the god of this world, and his intent is just to leave God out. So any idea that you should leave God out is basically a satanic idea that comes through the world. So Satan doesn't necessarily work on us directly as he works on us indirectly through the world. Let me illustrate. In Matthew chapter 16, Peter said to Jesus, he rebuked him for saying that he was going to go to Jerusalem, die, and be raised from the dead. And when Peter told the Lord that, he turned to Peter and said, get thee behind me, Satan. What you're thinking is of Satan and not of God, but of men. Well, now, which is it? Is it Satan or men? And the answer is, it's both. You see, That's how Satan works. He works through planting ideas in the world, and we are conformed to it, and behind it is Satan. In 1 Timothy, the Apostle Paul talks about the doctrine of demons. There are things taught by Satan. There are doctrines. The word means teaching. There are teachings taught by demons. And then he lists a few. One of being that you shouldn't eat meat. And some do that for health reasons, or they're vegetarians. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about some do it for religious reasons, thinking that's going to make them acceptable to God somehow. That's the demonic part. And forbidding to marry. And some religious orders teach that you shouldn't marry to serve God. Paul says that's a doctrine of demons, 1 Timothy. So, before we became Christians, and all those who are not, according to this passage, are separated from God, and as separated from God, they are being conformed to the world which is being energized by Satan. Now, there's one more description. There's several more. But in this line, he says in verse 3, among whom also we once conducted ourselves in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as others. Now, he's talked about three forces here. The world, the flesh, and the devil. We've talked about the world. We've talked about Satan. Now let's talk about the flesh. The flesh. We live according to the lust of the flesh. The word simply means desire. It isn't. The Greek word doesn't necessarily have sexual connotations. It's just the desires of the flesh. Sometimes it's translated lust as it is here, but that's not necessarily sexual. The simple truth is, we do what we want to do, right? Everybody we know, they just do what they want to do. Not what God wants them to do, what they want to do. And that's the point here. We live according to the desires of the flesh and of the mind. We do what we want to do. There was a speaker once who announced that he was going to speak on the subject, why your dog does what it does. And so all the pet lovers came, and he explained that a dog behaves like a dog because it has a dog's nature. He went on to explain that if somehow you could put a cat's nature and transplant it into the dog would act like a cat. And when you want to know why a human acts so sinfully as humans, it is because that's their nature. And in order to get them to change, to act some other way that is pleasing to God, you've got to give them some new nature. So he's saying we act according to the world, the flesh, and the devil. Then he says this. Latter part of verse 3. And we're by nature the children of wrath, just as others. Now he says we were all of this. He says that in the first part of that. We all once conducted ourselves. And then he says others. What's the difference? And most, virtually all commentators who study this passage say the we is... talking about the Jews, Paul is identifying himself with the Jews at this point, and the others is referring to Gentiles. But be all that as it may, the point is simply this, in that we are living according to the course of this world, according to the flesh, and behind all of that, Satan, that is the wrath of God. God is angry with those who live in such a way. They are not living according to the will and way of God. They are living according to the way of Satan, and God is angry at that. Isn't that interesting? Very, very interesting. There was a preacher of a bygone name, Day, who actually was a doctor who became a preacher. His name was Wilson. And he was going to a funeral once and was in the hearse with the funeral director. And the funeral director said to him, you know, the Bible doesn't make any sense to me. It talks about the dead burying the dead. And Dr. Wilson turned to him and said, well, that's what you're doing. According to the Bible, you are dead. And that is described as walking according to the course of the world, the course of the flesh, the course of Satan, with the wrath of God on you, but you're burying the dead. In other words, you are physically, you are spiritually dead, and you are burying the physical dead. All right, that's the description. You are dead. The point being, you don't have life. Look at verse 1. He made you alive who were dead, and in your dead state you walked according to the world, the flesh, and the devil, with God being angry at that. But the point of the passage is we were dead. We were not spiritually alive. Many years ago, there was an artist who carved out of marble the statue of an angel. And he wanted the opinion of the master, Michelangelo. So Michelangelo came over to evaluate this statue with the artist nearby, and Michael said, it's perfect except for one thing. And when the young artist heard that, he was crushed. Matter of fact, he was depressed. So finally, a friend went to Michelangelo and said, what did you mean about the thing that was lacking so he can correct it? And Michelangelo chuckled and said, it's perfect. It was great. All I meant was it was a statue of an angel and it wasn't alive. And all it lacked was life. Now that's the picture God has of those who aren't related to Him. They're dead, meaning they are separated from Him, meaning they don't have spiritual life. And in that state, they walk according to the world, the flesh, and the devil, and God's anger is toward them. It rests on them right now. A holy God is angry with sin. I know that's not popular these days, but it happens to be a biblical truth. All right, that's the first part of the passage. It describes what we were before we were saved. We were dead. Now, pick it up at verse 4, where he begins to describe what we are like now. He says, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ and raised us up together, verse 6, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ. So the first part of this passage is saying we were once dead. The second part is saying we were made alive. Amen. That's the point of these verses. Amen. Now look at what it says. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love which he loved us. Now we have to unwrap that. He was rich in mercy because he loved us. So which came first, the love or the mercy? Love. You got to think. Which came first? Love. Love. Right. So you got to start with love. God loved you. The Greek word means he wants what's best for you. Matter of fact, this particular word is used in the New Testament of seeking someone's highest good, even if that means a sacrifice to themselves. God loves us. Now, because he loves us, he had mercy on us. And the idea of mercy is simply compassion. Even when we were dead in sin. Did you see that? Look at verse 5. Even when we were dead in trespasses. Did you ever look at somebody that really, really messed up? I mean, they really blew it. They were disobedient, rebellious, and they broke the law and all kinds of things. And you You looked at them and say they got what they deserved. I'm disgusted with that kind of person. Well, God looked at us, saw all of our sin in our dead state, following the world, the flesh, and the devil, with all that's involved in that, and he loved us. He loved us. When we were separated from him, he loved us. And more than that, he was merciful to us and showed compassion upon us so that he made us alive. Now, if you follow the flow of the book, you will know that this is connected to God's power. Go back to chapter 1 and look at verse 19. What is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe? According to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. That's part of Paul's prayer at the end of chapter 1, where he's saying, I want you to understand the power of God. It's great. And instead of saying God created the world, wow, that would be power, he says, no. I want you to know the power of God in raising Christ from the dead. Now, there's no chapter break in the original text, and there shouldn't be in the English text. So he says in chapter 2, verse 1, and you he made alive who were dead with the resurrection of Christ. Amen. Keep in mind the picture. We were dead. And so God looked at us in that dead state. He loved us in that dead state. He had compassion on us in that dead state. And he made us alive. And it took the power of the resurrection to do that. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead physically was used to raise us from the spiritual dead spiritually. So he made us alive with Christ. Oh, by the way, you see at the latter part of verse 5, it's in parenthesis. By the way, he did that by grace. And then he says this. I want you to look at that verse very carefully. By grace you have been... Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. Where'd that word come from? What have we been talking about in this passage? You were dead and you were made alive. What's the common expression for that? Made alive. You were born again. That's what we talk about being born again. That's what we're talking about. God made us alive spiritually. We were born again. And so in this passage, he's talking about we're dead and he made us alive. The theologians call that regeneration, by the way. Same thing. And then he says, all that's being saved. He calls being dead and being made alive being saved. Did you see that? Subtle change in language here. We were saved from the penalty of sin and potentially saved from having to walk according to the course of this world, according to Satan, and according to the flesh. We got saved from all of that. So we use these expressions to talk about our relationship with the Lord. I've been saved. I've been born again. That's all described in this passage. Now, you were in the graveyard. You were in the dead. You were in the graveyard, so to speak, and dead, and God made you alive. But he didn't leave you in the cemetery. Read the next verse. And he raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So he not only made us alive, he raised us up into the heavenlies. In far as God is concerned, we, and this is the point, we have been united to Christ. He's in heaven, and as far as God is concerned, that's where we are. And not only that, we're seated with him. So God raised us, God made us alive, God raised us up, and God has seated us with Christ in the heavenly places. Now, all of that was done by grace. Did you see that? It was done by grace. Now, this is important. The power that God used to raise us from the dead was all by God's grace. The idea behind grace is that it's unmerited favor. In other words, I didn't do anything to receive it. I was given it without working for it. As a matter of fact, grace is even more than that. It's not just that I didn't earn it, it's I didn't deserve it. And this passage highlights that as well as any in the New Testament. I was separated from God, walking according to the world, the flesh, and the devil. God was angry at me. I didn't deserve God raising me from the dead. He just did it by His grace. I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it, but He saved me. He did that favor for me. So, believers then have been delivered from spiritual death and wrath by the great power and gracious love of God. They neither deserved to be saved, nor could they save themselves. They were hopelessly trapped in sin. But God, by His mercy and grace, saved them. He made believers alive. And all of that was by grace. You cannot do this. You cannot work for this. You cannot buy this. You can't be religious to get this. You can't live a righteous life to get this. God just gives it to you. That's grace. It's free. He just gives it to those who trust His Son. Centuries ago, in another land, a poor mother with a sick child scraped together what money she could to buy fruit from a wealthy prince who had a large vineyard. Finding the caretaker, she offered to buy a cluster of grapes, but he turned her away with the curt, "They are not to be sold. Do you think the prince grows these to be a peddler?" Not easily discouraged, she came back later to speak to someone else. This time she was ushered in to see the prince, who immediately handed her a basket full of the finest fruit of his vineyard. Placing it into the hands of the mother, he said, "We don't sell grapes, but we're always ready to give them to the poor." God doesn't sell this stuff. He gives it away. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Now, have a question. Why in the world would He do that? All right, He made it alive. He made us alive. He gave us a relationship with Himself by grace. Why would He do that? That answer is in the latter part of this passage, beginning at verse 7. Look at verse 7. That, stop. In the Greek text, the word "that" introduces a purpose clause. That. I'm now going to tell you the purpose for why God saved you by His grace. That in the ages to come He might show the exceeding riches of His grace in His kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. God saved us, made us alive to Him by grace, so that in the ages to come He might demonstrate His grace. That's why He saved us, to demonstrate His grace. By the way, He speaks in this verse of the exceeding riches of His grace. We saw that back in chapter 1, verse 7. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace. This grace was so rich that it made us alive. It saved us. It redeemed us. It got us the forgiveness of sins. All of those things are mentioned in these first two chapters. So, God saved us by grace to demonstrate His grace. Got it? Why did God save you? To show off His grace. Now, let's think about this in this context. He raised us how? I know you got to think. How did He raise us? By His power. Remember? Chapter 1 talked about power and it spilled over into chapter 2. So the resurrection of us demonstrates God's power. Saving us demonstrates His grace. I keep those two things separate. He could have exercised His power by making you do something. But He exercised His power, so it demonstrates His power. But that's not why He did it. He could demonstrate His power by flinging the worlds into space. He saved us because that demonstrates His grace, because we didn't deserve it. So the reason He saved us was to demonstrate His grace. Now, we come to one of the most famous verses in all of the New Testament. The one in this passage you've heard many times and probably could quote. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I want you to look at the first word of verse 8. What is the first word in verse 8? For. Now, you've heard me say before, and no doubt will hear me say again, when you see in the New Testament the word for at the beginning of a sentence, it means I'm about to explain to you what I just said. Verse 8 is explaining to us why God chose to save us by grace, to demonstrate His grace. Why did He do that? It is for by grace you are saved through faith. You see, it's grace. Paul says in the book of Romans, if it's by works, it's not of grace. If it's by faith, and if it's by grace, it's not of works. It's one or the other. It's either by God doing something freely or you doing something. Now, which is it? So he explains in verse 8, it's not by you doing anything. Anything. You don't have a relationship with God because you're good. In fact, according to this passage, we're all sinners. You don't have a relationship with God because you did something religious, like get baptized or join a church. It's not of yourselves. That's what verse 8 says. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's nothing we do. It's what God did. Now, why is that? It's because the whole point of this is to show what God could do. You need to understand verse 8 in the context of chapter 2. The point of which God saves us by grace to demonstrate His grace, and therefore you can't get saved by anything you do because that wouldn't demonstrate God's grace.
Amen.
Isn't that good? It's the gift of God. All right, can I get technical for a minute? May I? That was reluctant. Some come to this passage and say the gift is faith, that not only gives us salvation, He gives us faith. That is not the interpretation of this passage. And I know that, and this is the technical part, because the little word faith in the Greek text is in the feminine gender. Greek words have gender. And so it has to be related to some other word in the passage that is feminine. And it can't relate to grace. I mean, it can't relate to gift. That just doesn't fit the whole gender thing in this passage. But grace is in the feminine gender. So, this is not saying that the gift of God is faith. It's saying the grace is the gift. Salvation is the gift. So, God gives us the gift of eternal life. Now, let me pursue that just one more little second. The people who say that the gift here is faith are called Calvinists. And that sounds like they're following John Calvin, and they do to some degree, but on this issue they don't. John Calvin wrote a commentary on this passage, and he said, and I quote, "Many people restrict the word gift to faith alone, but Paul is not repeating, in other words, the former sentiment. His meaning is not that faith is the gift of God, but that salvation is given to us by God, or that we obtain it by the gift of God," end of quote. So those hearing me who are of a Calvinistic persuasion are going to think I'm denying Calvinism, and I am, but I'm not denying Calvin on this point. He said what I just said. Thought I'd throw that in. It's a technicality. The point is, salvation is not of works, lest any man should boast. If it were by something we do, which is the idea of works, we'd get to heaven, take our thumbs, stick them under our armpits, and say, ha-ha, look at me. Look at what I did. I was smarter than you. I trusted Christ. Or some other such thing. None of that. None of that. Why did God save us? To demonstrate His grace, therefore, there's nothing you can do to earn it. It is the gift of God. Therefore, the glory goes to God. So he says in verse 10, for. What does the word for mean? I'm going to explain something I just said. Now he's going to explain the explanation. And he says, for we are His workmanship. It's not that we work, it's that God worked. We're His workmanship. Matter of fact, the Greek word translated workmanship is the word from which we get the word poem. We are God's poem. Someone has said that the master artist is one who paints the clouds with rainbows, decks the flowers with their breathtaking hue, and makes everything beautiful in its time. And he made us a poem, a thing of beauty. He worked in us. We don't work for him in order to get salvation. So he says, we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Would you please look at the passage? He says in verse 9, not of works, but he says in verse 10, for good works. Let me translate. We are not saved by works. We are saved to go do good works. We don't do good works to get to heaven. We do good works because we're going. And if you do, you'll be rewarded for them. Ah. I think that perhaps the good works he has in mind are the things that are mentioned in the latter part of this book, which we will get to in due course. But I also think the phrase is broad enough to include all kinds of things. So, one author says, I know believers who've done good works. And he speaks of a man who was the owner of a shoe store, and he acquired very little wealth because he was so generous. If a poor family needed shoes, he gave a free pair to every child in the family. Or he spoke of another man who was a generous businessman who was known as having the fastest billfold in the state. That if he saw a need, he was the first to pull out his billfold and meet it. Or he talked about a lady who was always ready to care for a family when the mother was ill or when there was a new baby. So God created us unto good works. Harry Ironside tells the story of a man who stood up in a testimony meeting to tell of his conversion. He spoke of what Christ did for him and said nothing about what he had done. The leader of the meeting said to him, "You have told us only of the Lord's work in your heart, but you didn't relate to us what you did and what your part was first." To which the man replied, "I didn't forget to tell you about my part, but I will. My contribution was to run away from God for 30 years as fast as my sin would carry me. Then Jesus took after me until he finally caught me and rescued me. That was his part." And that's the story. Man is separated from God, and his part is to keep running from God, denying God, having nothing to do with God. And God pursues us and saves us by his work, grace. We are his workmanship, and all we did was believe. That's what verse 8 says. We believe. Meaning, we believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. We believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay for our sin. We believe that Jesus Christ arose from the dead. And if we trust him, we are given the gift of eternal life. Amen. The Bible says it just that clearly. Romans 6:23. The gift of God is eternal life. The gift. All I have to do is trust, and I receive the gift of God, which is life. He made me alive. It's salvation. I'm saved from the wrath of God. Wow. Now, one more thing in this passage. He says, which God prepared before that we should walk in them. Did you see that? We're not saved by works. We're saved unto works that God ordained that we should walk in them. That we, what's the next word? Should. Some preachers teach that if you're saved, you'll automatically work, and if you aren't working, you were never saved. You ever heard a preacher say that? Oh, yeah. Want to see whether or not you're saved? Look at your life. See if there's any fruit. It's not a biblical idea at all. You want to know if you're saved? Look at the cross. Don't look at yourself. Don't look at your works. That'll just do nothing but confuse you, because then you got to ask, well, did I do enough? Crazy. And then what do? Well, you look at the cross. That's how you get the assurance of your salvation. And you should work. Notice it didn't say you will work. Some say if you get saved, you will work. Bible says if you get saved, you should work. Others teach that if you get saved, you better work or you'll lose it. It didn't say you must work. It said you should work. Let me ask you a question. Are you grateful the Lord saved you? Amen. Then you should serve him. Amen. In order to get to heaven? No, that's backwards. He gave you the gift. Now you, out of gratitude, serve him. You should do that. You don't have to. That's radical. I know, it's as radical as the New Testament. Paul says in the book of Romans, chapter 4, to him that worketh not, but believes on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Did you hear that? To him that works not. Wow. You don't work, you still go if you trust Christ. So the sum of this passage is very simple. God makes spiritually dead people alive. That is, he saves them, seats them in heavenly places by grace in order to demonstrate his grace in the ages to come. If you want to reduce this whole thing to one short, simple sentence, it is this: God saves us by grace to demonstrate his grace. Amen and amen and amen. So, let me make a couple of applications and I'll close. Number one, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ, you need to do that. He did everything necessary for you to be forgiven of your sins, be made alive to him, and be saved from his wrath when he sent his son to die on the cross to pay for your sin and to be raised from the dead. All you have to do is trust Christ. It's not of works, it's of faith. Salvation is not a goal to be achieved. It is a gift to be received. Amen. May I repeat that? Salvation is not a goal to be achieved. It is a gift to be received. It is not by the merit of men. It is by the mercy of God. It is not by the goodness of people. It's by the grace of God. Amen. So if you've never trusted Christ, you could do that right where you're sitting listening to me. You could say in your heart of hearts, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus died for me, that Jesus arose from the dead, and I trust Him to get me to heaven and not anything I do. That is salvation. But if you have trusted Christ, you need to know that God wants you to walk in good works. He chose you before the foundation of the world, according to chapter 1, verse 4. He loves you and wants you to have a relationship with Him. That's the point of chapter 2. But He also determined beforehand that you should walk in good works, not in order to get to heaven, but because you're already there. You're in the heavenlies in Christ. And finally, I would say, and this is the point of this passage, if you've trusted Christ, you need to know and you need to remember that God saved you by grace to demonstrate His grace. Why did God save me? Because I did something nobody else did? No. All I did was mess up. Why did God save me? Because I'm smarter than somebody else? No. God saved me so He could say, let me show you how great my grace is. I saved that guy. Right? Amen. If you have any other attitude toward your salvation, you've missed the point. Amen. Before the Civil War, when blacks in the South were still slaves, two white men on horses came upon a black lady washing clothes on a scrub board in a creek, and she was singing hymns. The men knew her, and she knew them, and they just stopped by to water their horses, and they thought they would kid her a little bit, and she knew that's what was happening. At any rate, they said to her, Mammy, do you think God's going to take the likes of you to heaven? Why, you're just a slave. And looking up from her scrub board, she said, Yessa, God's going to take me to heaven. And one of those men asked, why would God do a thing like that? And she says, I'll tell you, when I gets to heaven, God's going to take a number 10 wash tub, turn it upside down, put me on the top of it, and then He's going to call all His children round and say, look at what my grace can do.
Amen.
And I submit to you that all who get to heaven are trophies on top of a wash tub. Amen.